Well, hello there, trivia fans, and welcome to week number four of Trivia Never Dies, where we recycle the trivia so that you don't have to. Let's get right to it, shall we? You should know the ground rules by now. No cheating on Google, keep track of your own score, and just have fun. Five categories for you today, as always, 7 to 10 questions per category. So, let's begin. This session today was taken from the trivia contest held at the library in October 2019, just last year. So you can expect us perhaps a fallish type question or some sort of question topical for the time. Not this one, though. This one, this next category, this first category transcends them all. This has to do with something that we all know and love, and that is candy. Category one is all about candy. Question number one. President Ronald Reagan famously loved what specific brand of jelly beans? President Ronald Reagan famously loved what specific brand of jelly beans? And as always, since this is a recorded session, you can pause your device if you need time to think about the question before we before you move on to the next one. For our part, however, we're going to keep it moving, okay? Question number two. What candy bar was named after its inventor's horse? What candy bar was named after its inventor's horse? Number three. What candy bar had the slogan, "The Great American Chocolate Bar"? You remember that slogan? What candy bar had the slogan, "The Great American Chocolate Bar"? Question four, this chocolate-flavored taffy-like candy was the first penny candy to be individually wrapped in America. This chocolate-flavored, taffy-like candy was the first penny candy to be individually wrapped in America. Question five. What popular Halloween candy was originally called chicken feed? What popular Halloween candy was originally called chicken feed? All right. Now, questions 6 through 10 are actually going to be incorporated into a little worksheet that I have for you. And that's coming up on your screen right about now. They've taken 10 candy bars, popular candy bars, and cross-sectioned them. You need to identify the candy bar from its cross-section. So, go ahead and pause your device. Get your paper and pencil and write down, number it 1 to 10, and write down your answers as best you can, identifying the candy bar, the name of the candy bar from its cross-section. Okay, so go ahead, and since you're unpaused now, let's continue. Let's go back and review the answers to the to category one, candy. All right. President Ronald Reagan famously loved what specific brand of jelly beans? Those were Jelly Bellies. Jelly Bellies, if you'll recall. What candy bar was named after its inventor's horse? That is Snickers. Snickers was the name of the horse and then subsequently the candy bar. What candy bar had the slogan, "The Great American Chocolate Bar"? Of course, that's Hershey's. The Great American Chocolate Bar. Number four, this chocolate-flavored taffy-like candy was the first penny candy to be individually wrapped in America. That is the famous Tootsie Roll. And the popular Halloween candy, originally called chicken feed, we call candy corn now. Looks like something you'd grab a handful of and scatter it on the ground for the chickens, doesn't it? And question six, that was the toughie, wasn't it? Naming those candy bars from their cross sections. Here is the answer key right here. So why don't you take a look? I'll give you a minute here and see how you did with identifying those candy bars. Go ahead and pause it if you want to compare the images along with the answers. Okay, very good. Well, how did you do on that one? That's an interesting category. Whether you have a sweet tooth or not, we all love candy. All right, remember that we broadcast this, or we had this contest in October, so Halloween was coming up, and it seemed very, very fitting to us that we should have a category about Halloween. So let's see if we can't push that out to you here. You have to have a scary Halloween picture here, don't you? Yeah, of course you do. Halloween. Halloween is the category. And here is the first question. Where did Halloween get its name? Break it down for us. Where did Halloween get its name? And again, pause if you need some time to think about it and to jot down your answer or make a mental note of it. We are going to move on to question number two. This Halloween tradition was once known as guising. This Halloween tradition was once known as guising. Question three. Boris Pickett's hit song reached number one in 1962, appropriately, just before Halloween. Boris Pickett's hit song reached number one in 1962, appropriately, just before Halloween. According to candystore.com, what is the top selling Halloween candy in the United States? According to candystore.com, what is the top selling Halloween candy in the U.S.? Question five, what type of demon originating from Arab mythology supposedly robs graveyards and feeds on human beings? Question five reads, what type of demon originating from Arab mythology supposedly robs graveyards and feeds on human beings? Question number six, Halloween's traditional colors are orange and black. What do these colors signify? Give yourself a point for each that you correctly identify. What do the colors orange and black signify? Those being Halloween's traditional colors. Question number seven. The Transylvania of Dracula lore is located in which country? The Transylvania of Dracula lore is located in which country? Question number eight, what do you call a ghost that moves things around your house? Goes bump in the night, I guess. What do you call a ghost that moves things around your house? Question nine, what natural phenomenon brought Frankenstein's monster to life in the movie of the same name? Question 9. What natural phenomenon brought Frankenstein's monster to life in the movie of the same name? And question number 10 is a two-parter. Halloween originated in what country? So we need the name of a country where the observance of Halloween originated. And as a bonus, before pumpkins, what vegetable was carved into jack-o'-lanterns at Halloween? So Halloween originated in what country? That's one part. And then the bonus is, before pumpkins, what vegetable was carved into jack-o'-lanterns at Halloween? Take your best guess as to those, and we will go back and review our answers to question or category number two, Halloween. Are you ready? Here we go. Where did Halloween get its name? From the Scottish All Hallows Eve, meaning All Saints Eve. You see, November 1st, the day after, is All Saints Day for many Christian traditions. In Scots, the word Eve, it means even, and this is contracted to een, hence All Hallows Even, or een, becomes Halloween. So there you go, in a nutshell. This Halloween tradition was once known as guising. That would be trick-or-treating, or dressing up in disguise and visiting others' homes or neighborhoods. So if you came close to that, go ahead and give yourself a point. Boris Pickett's hit song in reached number one in 1962, appropriately just before Halloween.
The match.
He did the monster match.
The monster match.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the match.
Okay, there you go. Even with the sample of the song, the monster mash was the answer. Number four, according to candystore.com, the top-selling Halloween candy in the United States is Skittles. The type of demon originating from Arab mythology that feeds on human beings is a ghoul. Halloween's traditional colors are orange and black. What do they signify? Life and death. Orange being the color that symbolizes the harvest, bounty, life, and black, death. The Transylvania of Dracula lore is located in the country of Romania. And a ghost that goes bump in the night, moving things around your house, is a poltergeist. The natural phenomenon that brought Frankenstein's monster to life was lightning, or if you said electricity, that's fine too. Go ahead and put that down as an answer, or give yourself a point. And the two-parter and the last question, Halloween originated in the country of Ireland. And before pumpkins, turnips were commonly carved into jack-o'-lanterns at Halloween. Turnips. So, tote up your results there and see what you came up with. So we finished two categories now, and we are about to move on to our third. The third will be a pretty straightforward category for you. We are calling it simply States of the Union. And what we're going to do is give you a map of the United States with, instead of state names given, all we have is a number assigned to the particular state. So what you need to do is grab a piece of paper and jot down 1 through 50 and identify the states, every single one of them that you can name. Give yourself a point each. So if you're good at geography, you're good at state geography, you should clean up on this one big time. If you're not so much, well, then this one could be your Waterloo. We'll see. So go ahead and number your answer sheet 1 through 50. Go ahead and answer the questions. Put this on pause. When you come back, we will continue and I will show you the correct answers to this category, States of the Union. Go ahead and pause now, please. Okay, so we are back. The category was States of the Union. You diligently identified all 50, I'm sure. What I did was I gave you a map that had all of the states labeled with numbers. You identified the state by number. And so here is the answer sheet, 1 through 50, the states of the Union by number. Take a moment, pause the recording, and see how you did. Compare your answers to the answer sheet here. Give yourself a point for each correct identification. Well, how did you do on that category, states of the Union? Many of us think that we know more than we actually do when it comes down to identifying them by shape like that or by location. It's a little tougher than it appears, especially when you get into those little tiny states in the northeast of the country. So hopefully you did well and you racked up a whole bunch of points on that one category alone. Okay, well, before we go on to category 4, we have, as always, a little commercial announcement from one of the other staff at the library. This from Veronica Grossbeck, the children's librarian. Take it away, Veronica.
Hello, today I want to tell you about the Sync audiobook program. Every week from now until July, Audiophile is releasing 2 teen audiobooks that you can download and keep for free. All you have to do is go to audiobooksync.com, register, download the Sora app, and enter the code audiobooksync. And don't forget to check back each week because the titles are only available to download the week they're released. This week's titles are Picture Us in the Light and Secret Soldiers. So go to audiobooksync.com and download them today.
Thank you very much, Veronica, for that message. Good information for everybody to know. All right, let's continue on with our trivia for week 4, category 4 now this time. This one is a specialized category. We always have a literary category since we're a library. This one is about the great author Edgar Allan Poe. Edgar Allan Poe. So if you're a literary sort, especially of American classic literature, you might do well on this category. We'll see how things go. Question 1 in the category, Edgar Allan Poe. What NFL team is named for one of Poe's greatest poems? What National Football League team is named for one of Poe's greatest poems? As always, pause if you need some extra time to think about your response. Question 2, he was originally known just as Edgar Poe. Later, Allan was added. Where did that come from? Where did the Allan part of his name originate from? Question 3, for over 70 years, a mysterious figure would visit Poe's grave on his birthday and leave items behind. What were those items? For over 70 years, a mysterious figure would visit Poe's grave on his birthday and leave items behind. What were those items? All right, now we've got an identification mini quiz for you, 1 through 5. Poe was famous for some of his short stories. Give yourself a point for each where you can identify the name of the short story by its description on the left. So, on question 1, a slowly descending, ever so sharp blade was the theme behind the name of what short story by E.A. Poe? Number 2, what's that thumping beneath the floorboards? What short story does that pertain to? Number 3, the first modern detective story introducing the detective C. Auguste Dupin. Number 4, a costume party gone terribly wrong. What is that short story about? Or what is the name of that short story? Number 5, the ultimate revenge with cement and trowel. So go ahead and pause and think about your responses here. Jot them down and we will be moving on. Question 5, Poe died under mysterious circumstances in what city? Poe died under mysterious circumstances in what city? Okay, question number 6. Poe had a keen interest in this field, which deals with the art of writing or solving codes. Poe had a keen interest in this field, which deals with the art of writing or solving codes. Number 7. Poe's biological parents shared the same occupation. What was that occupation? Poe's biological parents shared the same occupation. What was that occupation? And our last question of category 4, true or false, Poe sold The Raven to a literary journal for over $200, an amazing sum in its day. Is that true or is that false? Got a 50% chance of being right on that one, correct? All right. Let's review. Answers to Category 4's questions on Edgar Allan Poe, the great American author. What NFL team is named for one of Poe's greatest poems? That would be the Ravens, the Baltimore Ravens. He was originally known as just Edgar Poe. The Allen part came from his foster parents, John and Frances Allen. Number 3, for over 70 years, a mysterious figure would visit Poe's grave and leave cognac and 3 roses. So if you came somewhere close to that, to give yourself at least partial credit. Name the short story from these brief descriptions. A slowly descending, ever so sharp blade was from The Pit and the Pendulum. The Pit and the Pendulum. What's that thumping beneath the floorboards? That is the telltale heart. The first modern detective story introducing the detective C. Auguste Dupin is Murders in the Rue Morgue. I have no idea if I pronounced that name in French correctly. number 4, a costume party gone terribly wrong was in the Mask of the Red Death. And number 5, The Ultimate Revenge with Cement and Trowel, The Cask of Amontillado, or Amontillado. I'm not sure how you say that either. All right, give yourself a point for each of those correct identifications. Now, number 5, Poe died under mysterious circumstances in the city of Baltimore, Maryland. He had a keen interest in cryptography, which deals with the art of writing or solving codes. Poe's parents were both actors. True or false, Poe sold The Raven, one of his most famous poems, to a literary journal for over $200, an amazing sum in its day. No, not quite. He sold it for $9. So the answer is false. $9 for one of the more famous pieces of literature in American history. Incredible. All right. How did you do on that category? I have a feeling a few of you are probably wanting to throw me under the bus right about now for that category. Let's see if I can make it up to you with something perhaps a little less intense, something a little bit closer to home. It's a category that should be kind of fun, actually. And I call that. If we can get that up there. See if my technical staff can bring that up there. Technical staff being me. there we go. Iconic TV lines. Iconic TV lines is our final category for this trivia session. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a line that is rather iconic from the land of television, and you need to identify who said it, and for extra credit, where they said it. In other words, what show or what program were they involved with where that became iconic? And we have exactly, we've got quite a few. We've got 20 of these, okay? So name, number your sheets, 1 through 20. You're going to get a point potentially for identifying the character or actor who said that. Actually, we're hoping for the character name and the show that it was from. So there's 20 of them. So potentially, if you get everything right, you can get 40 points in this particular category, which is a huge number. Give yourself just 1 point, obviously, if you only get part of that correct. So let's begin with question number one. And that's the way it is. Who said that, and what show or program was that person involved with? So again, you may need to pause this recording periodically. We're going to just move on. Most of these are pretty, you either know them or you don't. So here we go with number two. Bazinga. Bazinga. Who said that? And on what show? Question three, Book'em Dano. Book'em Dano. Number four, Come On Down. Come On Down. Number five, Bam. Bam is number five. Number six, Danger Will Robinson. Danger Will Robinson. Number seven, Deplane Deplane. Who, what character said that? And what show is that from? Number eight, Dope. Dope. Who made that little phrase famous? Number nine, Elizabeth, I'm coming. Elizabeth, I'm coming. Number 10, Good Night, John Boy. Good Night, John Boy. Question 11, How you doing? How you doing? Question number 12, If it weren't for you meddling kids. If it weren't for you meddling kids. Number 13, just one more thing. Number 13, just one more thing. Question number 14, Nip It. Nip It. Number 15, is that your final answer? Is that your final answer? Number 16, say goodnight, Grace. Number 16 is say goodnight, Grace. Number 17, suit up. Suit up. Number 18, this is the city. This is the city? Number 19, the tribe has spoken. The tribe has spoken. And our last question, number 20, is Marsha. Marsha. All right, let's review the answers to Category 5, Iconic TV Lines. Question 1, And That's the Way It Is, was made famous by Walter Cronkite on the CBS Evening News. In the original contest, these clips actually played. They don't now, for whatever reason, so you'll just see a still there, which may or may not accurately represent the answer. I'm sorry for that. Number 2, Bazinga was made famous by the character Sheldon Cooper on Big Bang Theory. Bookum Dano was a favorite saying of Steve McGarrett, the detective on Hawaii Five-O, the 70s police procedural. That is not Steve McGarrett there. Come On Down, why, that was made famous by Johnny Olson, a very blurry Johnny Olson on The Price is Right. Come on now! You remember that high-pitched little voice of his. Bam! This was a new one on me. Bam was made famous by the online cook, or on TV screen personality, cook Emeril Lagasse. Lagasse? I never watched the show, so help me with the pronunciation. Emeril Live was the name of the show. This one I did watch back when I was a kid. Danger, Will Robinson. That was from The Robot in Lost in Space. Thought that was the coolest show. De plane was the famous saying of Tattoo on Fantasy Island. There he is, just about ready to enter the little watchtower area there where he spots the plane and makes that famous pronouncement. De plane. Do was by Homer Simpson of The Simpsons. Elizabeth, I'm coming was a favorite saying of Fred Sanford on the comedy Sanford and Son. Usually said when he was trying to elicit sympathy from someone. Pretended like he was having a heart attack. Number 10, Good Night, John Boy. That was generally said by all the folks in the Waltons, so this one really didn't have 2 points attached to it, a sayer and a show. So I lied earlier about 40 points being possible in this category. It's really probably 39. How you doing? Joey Tribbiani said that very often in the show Friends. If it weren't for you meddling kids. That was said by various villains in the show Scooby-Doo, Where Are You? Those kids were just too crafty for those bad evildoers. Just one more thing was the maddening mantra of Peter Falk in Columbo. The bad guy thought he had Peter beat, and Peter would always come back with just one more thing, and it usually was the thing that cracked the case. Nippet was, and you're not going to see much here but a black screen. Maybe you can see Barney faintly there with Thelma Lou. Barney Fife on the Andy Griffith Show is famous for periodically saying, you gotta nip it in the bud. Nip it! Is that your final answer? Comes from Regis Philbin on the show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Question 16, Say Goodnight, Grace. That's reaching back a few years now, and that was from George Burns. He would say that on the Burns and Allen show for Gracie Allen. Say goodnight, Grace. Suit Up, that's by Barney Stinson on How I Met Your Mother, that TV series. Now, if I say it monotone, this is the city. Does that help you at all? That, of course, was Sergeant Joe Friday on Dragnet. Los Angeles, California. Number nine, The Tribe Has Spoken. That's Jeff Probst in Survivor. Survivor, the show Survivor. And, of course, this often imitated saying, Marcia, Marcia, Marcia. Everybody in the world named Marcia has had that directed at them. That's by Jan Brady on The Brady Bunch. The Brady Bunch, that 70s serial TV show. Okay, well, hopefully you did pretty well on those, or at least had fun with that. Take you back a few years on some of those. All right, we are ready to move on to our final trivia segment of the broadcast. Okay, we are moving on to final trivia, operated very much like Final Jeopardy on the TV show, where you're able to wager some or all of your accumulated points based on your confidence in your ability to answer the category. The category that you have today is state capitals, so based on your confidence on that, make your wager, please. All right, let's move on to the question itself. The question in the category state capitals for final trivia is, it is the only three-word state capital. It is the only three-word state capital. All right, I'll give you some time, and you can think that over. Write down your answer. Pause the recording if need be. All right, let's go back and take a look at the answer to the question. It is the only three-word state capital. That would be Salt Lake City. Salt Lake City, Utah. The only three-word state capital in the U.S. Interesting. Okay. All right. Well, how did things turn out for you? If you got that question right in final trivia, go ahead and add that to your point total. If not, subtract it. That's the way the game's played. I hope you did well, but even if you didn't, I hope you had fun and maybe learned a thing or two. Thanks again for paying attention today and for participating. And if you care to, tune in next week for session number 5 of Trivia Never Dies. You take care. This is Steve signing off. Be safe and have a good week ahead.